down our land. Well, that'll be the day when you say goodbye. Yes, that'll be the day when you make me cry. You say you're gonna leave. You know it's a lie, 'cause that'll be the day when I die. Well, you give me all your love and you give the hurt of love. All your hugs and kisses and your money to hell. You know you love me, baby. Do you tell me maybe that someday we'll all be
through? It's hump day and welcome to Wednesday Winos. We come together on Wednesdays at 8 p.m. to taste everything delicious and everything that's tasty from Yarra Valley. So, and because it's Wednesday, let's do it. So I'm Rebecca, I'm from Kangaroo Ridge Retreat, and I'm here with
Hanna from Watts River Brewing. And I was going to pop my I'm very excited, but we should introduce our guests.
Yes, we should.
Do you guys want to introduce yourself?
Oh, hang on.
Oh, you've got them on mute. Hang on.
Okay, try again.
He's muted.
We can hear you now.
Hi, guys. So I'm Brad, and this is my partner, Matthew. We're from Steelgate Winery. Thanks for having us today.
Thank you. We've been waiting all day to do that.
What are we drinking today?
When we pop the cork, we'll show you how to do it properly. Oh. Put the bottle and not the cork, and don't make it pop because you pop your bubbles. Do it nice.
I knew I was doing it wrong. I'm very uncouth.
So, guys, we're going to start off today with our latest sparkling, which is our 2017 Blanc de Blanc.
Lovely.
Bit of a personal favourite of mine. So hopefully everyone's kicking back, relaxing, enjoy the last of those.
So we're starting off initially in a traditional flute, which most people are going to be familiar with. For many people nowadays, they go into a wine glass.
Yeah, a bit of a trend, especially in the US going on at the moment, that, you know, it's all about the wine glass again, that, you know, it'll be interesting to see is if people move away from flutes.
And go back to tradition.
And back to traditional.
Traditional.
Either way, it doesn't matter how you drink it, as long as you enjoy it, right?
So there's no wrong or right way.
Cheers. So because I had a couple of technical issues when I started, I completely threw our introduction out the window. So I'm so sorry about that. I wanted to let you know that we are simulcasting both, actually on three places today. We're simulcasting on Kangaroo Ridge's Facebook page, also Yarra Ranges and Dandenong Ranges Tourism page, but also Watts River Brewing. So if you've got any questions, please put it in the comments and then we'll put it up on the screen here. But particularly welcome Matt and Brad from Steelsgate Wines again, and we're drinking two wines tonight, a Blanc de Blanc and also the Chardonnay as well, and then we'll talk about it. A big shout out to last week, we had Dan from Dayton Brewery, and yeah, we discovered all about the pandemic punch, but let's move on and let's start with the show. So tell us about the Blanc de Blanc.
Yeah, absolutely. First, I'm going to say hi to George. I can see he's just sent us a little message there. Nice to hear from you. Hope you're well. Today, I thought it'd be a bit of fun to look at these two wines in particular. Matt and I have been in the industry, well, producing for about 10 years now. And it's all started on the property where this sparkling is from. So our home block is located at the back of Steels Creek. It's currently 45 years old, dry grown, and completely surrounded by King Lake National Park. So a really, really beautiful space, really protected site. And the next one we're going to look at is our Chardonnay. So 2 years ago, we decided to leave corporate, hang up the suits, and actually be a bit more serious about this and open our first cellar door and restaurant in Dixons Creek. So the reason we chose this particular site is it's pretty much a dry grown site, although we're taking that further to full dry grown. It's a similar age, it's about 40 years old, just on the other side of the hill in Dixons Creek. So it's really great to look at terroir. So two Chardonnays, first being a sparkling, but just looking at how environment, how soil, how altitude really influences fruit complexity. So within the business, both Matt and I are the vignerons that we grow and make the wine together. Primarily, Matt oversees all the viticulture, and I'll oversee all the cellar door and restaurant side, but together we'll come together and we'll make the wine. So starting off with the Blanc de Blanc.
Yeah, so tell us about this, yeah.
Yeah. So this is all method traditionnel. The Chardonnay is basically the property here at home is 50-50 Pinot and Chardonnay. And it's a very, very steep property. So we're about altitude.
About 230 metres above sea level.
230, yeah.
Up to about 280, 290. And then top of the property is over 300, like 350. So it's a very steep property. We can't grow grapes on the extremely steep side, but certainly on the lower side we do.
So with that, sorry.
So I was going to ask, which way does it face? East, west?
Our older Pinot, so most of our Pinot is 40, 45 years old, and that is sort of northwestish. Okay. It sort of gets the morning sun more than the afternoon sun. Our Chardonnay is very southwesterly, so that gets a good afternoon sun. And then 7 years ago, we planted some more Pinot, which that is sort of also more of your westerly kind of southwesterly. So it's interesting too with the Pinot that we get quite different characteristics from the old vines and the new vines, but mostly the terroir, as Brad was talking about, the soil really drives the uniqueness into our Pinot as well.
Got a couple of questions. Do the eucalypts from the national park have any impacts on your wine flavors?
Yes, it does. It's a very good question.
Well done, dear.
It's very, very unique to Steeles Creek. And unless you really know what you're looking for, it's not so evident in the beginning. And it's more seen in our Pinot Noir because that's kind of that top corner that it really is surrounded by those eucalypts, very, very old eucalypts. But for us, it's the nature of the site. That's where this vineyard is grown and it's reflective and it's true of it. You can't take down the national park.
Yep.
So we embrace it. Less seen on the Pinot Noir from our cellar door because obviously there's less gum trees, eucalypts around the property.
But it's interesting too. It seems to be year on year, now that we're really getting into it, our 2016 vintage had quite an influence from the eucalyptus trees. But then over time that, you kind of lost that flavour or the sense from it. A lot of people won't even pick it up, but knowing...
Yeah.
Pinot and knowing what you get very much influenced.
Is it more of a chance that you miss it when you taste another Pinot and then you notice the difference?
I think you would. You may not necessarily pick up what it is. So it'd be good to do some back-to-back tastings, maybe even we don't have a lot left of 16, 17, but certainly you can do sort of a back-to-back tasting of the vintages and sort of see what they do, a vertical tasting.
Mm-hmm. I've got another question from Simon. That could you please elaborate on some of the dry grown aspects? What does that involve?
Absolutely. So I guess this comes back to kind of our philosophy, everything that we do. We're very environmentally conscious and we're really focused on not – adding unnecessary things to the vineyard. So we're very fortunate to purchase already a very old vineyard. But the benefit of dry grown is that you don't add water unnecessarily. Now, from a business perspective, you do get far less fruit, but you get much, much better quality fruit, much more interesting fruit, a lot more fruit intensity, complexity. Essentially what you're doing is when you irrigate, you get a lot more, the root system is closer to the surface. when you don't irrigate, those roots actually go a lot further down. Apologies, our son's in the background laughing at the back there. So I so those roots do go a lot deeper down, and with that, obviously going through different layers of soil and complexity.
So there are some other things that there are certainly benefits that we see. We've now started to go to non-herbiciding, so we don't spray the weeds underneath the vines. And so when you have a dry-grown vineyard with those root system further down, the vines aren't so much competing for the water as they would be under traditional sort of irrigated vines for that water and maybe the nutrients because the roots are further down. But also if we get late rains, and we often do in the Yarra Valley, so if you get a January, February rain, those vines suck that rain up if they're non-irrigated. So if they're used to getting water and suddenly late in the season they get water, it can swell the berries, which could either, one, delay the harvest. And a lot of the bigger wineries, they certainly can't afford to do that, balancing your time of when things are coming off. But it also can split your grapes. So if you get too much rain and then the vines take too much up, it could split a grape and then you have botrytis issues, which is, again, something else we don't want.
Interesting. So yeah, those drier berries are more concentrated, more, packing bigger punch. Yeah.
Possibly smaller berries, or less fruit. So we may not get as much, but that means that the vines, they put more into what they're producing. A lot of vineyards drop fruit to sort of then get that sort of intensity. We tend to not need to drop too many grapes because we don't get as much being dry grown.
Got another question about being dry grown, also from Benjamin Hamilton. Is that very common? This is a common method in the Yarra Valley. We had now here a couple of weeks ago.
Yeah.
They could do the dry growth method. But do you know any others?
Yes, Bobar Wines.
Yep.
I believe Luke Lambert is planning his own vineyard for the first time. And he will be doing that dry grown. So a lot of the more smaller boutique producers definitely are seeking after dry grown. It's just the better way to go for one environment and if you want to be reflective
We also can't guarantee in Australia that we're going to have the water available to irrigate. We don't know what's happening with the climate. And if your vines are relying on being irrigated, we've had years here where, again, we don't really irrigate. We've got a dam, we've got two dams, but they're nearly empty and we haven't been using the water. So
yeah,
there's a lot of, again, onset environmental issues that you got to sort of manage with that also.
Yeah.
George is saying that Yarra Yering are also dry grown.
Thank you. Yep. Of course.
Definitely. Bit more about the sparkling and
yeah. Sorry, I was going to ask about the method. Yeah. Can you explain that? What is that?
Sparkling wine has a lower alcohol than a table wine. Blanc de Blanc is white of white, so it's 100% Chardonnay for ourselves. So it can be any white really. It's a lower alcohol because we pick the fruit early. We pick the fruit early because we want high acidity. So as the sugars increase in the grapes, you get reduced acidity. And back to our minimal intervention, we really don't want to add anything. So we really don't want to add acid. So that is, it's a common practice.
Yep.
A lot of the valley in the last couple of years has had very low acid, and so they've had to add it. We traditionally have to add none or very, very little.
Yeah, definitely not in the sparkling, especially at this the home block here. We don't add. It's just naturally high acidity. I think the altitude and positioning allows for that. So yeah, makes a really interesting sparkling.
It's delicious.
This is, thank you, all method traditionnel. So it's spent about
2.5 years on lees.
2.5, getting up to 3 years on lees. So basically we make the table wine, and once we're happy with that, we actually send this off to a facility in Romsey. They're a sparkling expert and they cater for the majority of the Yarra Valley. Obviously not Domaine Chandon and Yering Station. They have their own facilities. In order to make sparkling, it's very technical and it's very, very expensive. Now you can do this yourself by hand, and we've experienced that, and it's beautiful and wonderful. But the variances in each bottle differ, which is one thing that I find challenging when you have a cellar door. It's a bit of a surprise sometimes. So we've found this company that are just truly experienced, and it's all machine operated. So we get to go out there. It's taken care of, and once you hit the amount of time that you're happy for that to sit in bottle and naturally ferment, you then get back involved to finish the winemaking process.
So to get back to alcohol, I suppose we will make a base wine. This particular one, we're 11.5. When we send it up as a base wine, it's probably around about 11, maybe a bit under 11. And same as making homebrew or beer. So if you make a beer using traditional bubbling methods, once you bottle the beer, you then add a bit more yeast into it, and then seal it. And so that yeast produces carbon dioxide and alcohol. The carbon dioxide stays in there and naturally ferments the beer. If you're doing a mainstream beer like a Carlton Draft, you make the base beer, you send it to the pub, and they throw CO2 into it, and that's how you carbonate it. So there's no extra alcohol. So same with the sparkling wine. Once they put that extra bit of nutrients and the yeast back in, the yeast will produce alcohol and carbon dioxide. And given it's sealed in the bottle, and then it sits on that gooey, yummy yeast for a couple of years, and it produces that sort of the creaminess and that yeastiness that you get from a method traditional versus, say, a Prosecco, which is done through Charmat sparkling, it's sparkled in a tank under pressure, and that gives more of that cleaner kind of a sparkling. And if you're in a flute, more so than, say, in here, you can see the bead a lot more, and the bead is a lot finer with a method traditional versus when it's been artificially carbonated.
Yeah.
Are you getting that really, the thing I enjoy about the sparkling is on that back palate, are you getting that beeswax coming through?
Or honeysuckle.
Honeysuckle, beeswax, yeah.
So we were doing a photo shoot on the top of the ridge today. And when we finished with all the, we use your sparkling as part of the sunset up there, and if they ask for sparkling, and I popped it open, and then it's like what I did taste when I did that was green apple. Is that something that's normally described with that,
mm-hmm,
other than honeysuckle? Green apple was like, ooh.
Earlier on or afterwards? Sorry, I missed that part.
Right in the beginning, like right in the beginning.
Before I had a chance to open up.
Yeah.
And that's when you when you make wine, especially when it's lower alcohol, it starts off with that. It's without getting too technical, that balance of malic acid, basically. So you've got your more green apples, and then as it goes through this process, you move into your softer flavors. Yeah. So for us, it's finding that balance of something where you get that bit more tartness through to that full sweetness. And for those of you that have out there that have come to our cellar door, we don't enjoy really sweet wine. All of our wine is sugar dry, and just keep it a little bit more on that high.
You're talking my language now.
Yeah.
But now I can kind of smell a honeysuckle smell now with the openness.
When it opens up, yeah, absolutely.
I like
what's giving that character.
A few things. One, the fruit itself, dry grown, really interesting old Chardonnay fruit. And then the second thing is the amount of time that it's spent fermenting in the bottle. The thing for us, Blanc de Blanc really comes into its own about 5 or 6 years in the bottle. And the first sparkling we ever made, we did leave it about 5 years on lees. It was really exciting and beautiful. Unfortunately, our sparkling's been a little popular, so we've had to look at that balance of going, what's something that's still interesting enough to meet that demand? But now as we've scaled up, we have quite a lot of sparkling sitting down, and we'll be able to get back into that 5-6 years, as well as magnums. And
I presume having it on lees for 5 years is a lot more costly to produce.
Yeah.
It is. So absolutely, with method traditional, you'll pay more than your Prosecco and things, because it's a longer process. Absolutely. The older it is, the more complexity, the more time it you know, you need to put in storage and do things.
Yep.
So that does add to cost.
And there is, you know, there's still the reeling process where, you know, every so often it's got to be rotated. And so there is some labor involved in
machinery, yeah.
How you sort of store it.
Yeah.
You know, that's why you need to use an expert. So you do about a quarter turn of the bottle every, 3 months, I think it is?
Yep.
And so that it sits, can't demonstrate it now because they're all open, but on its neck and all of the lees is throughout the wine. Once it's time for disgorging, they then put a little
syringe
chemical in to really help bind up that yeast and the lees. And then it sits upside down on its neck still. So all of that congregates down towards the cap because it doesn't have a cork in it at that stage. They then freeze that very quickly with nitrogen and then open the bottle and it explodes out. So you lose a bit of the product, you then top it back up and then you dosage it. So you add a little bit
of syrup. Yeah, exactly.
It is heartbreaking. If I was there, I think I'd be sitting there trying to catch it.
Yeah.
I was going to say the really interesting part of this is obviously making the base wine. You've got to start off with a really good base. Otherwise, you're just sparkling something that's not great. But it's also the end process that once it's gone through and it's developed that complexity and really interesting, toasty qualities, it is about that dosage. So for those, you know, that have never seen or experienced that, it's literally taking a bottle and basically looking at different trials of different levels of sugar and then depending on what style you're wanting to make is balancing all that out. So it is a fun process. This has actually got 5 grams per liter of sugar added at the end, so not high, but it does offset that natural acidity.
So delicious.
Because you harvested early, you don't get that sweetness in the fruit because you don't want – so firstly, you want the acid. Secondly, you don't want that stronger fruit character in a sparkling, but that would then make it – it makes it too tart. Most people would not like it without any dosaging.
Yeah.
Mm. Okay. So we spent a lot of time on the Blanc de Blancs, even though delicious. I think we should move on to
– boiling. Chardonnay.
Show the Chardonnay bottle because – someone stole my Chardonnay bottle.
I can do that.
Just have the bottle.
This is my absolute favorite. I love Chardonnay. Chardonnay for me is the most exciting. It's the easiest grape that takes on terroir. It's the wine that the less you do, the more interesting it becomes. So again, having a dry grown vineyard, Matt really focusing on, you know, the organic matter going back in, that we're not using pesticides, you end up with this really beautiful grape complex. Quite easy to make. You literally press it off, put it into your barrel and allow it to ferment naturally. Well, this is all wild yeast. So this is really, really site specific. It's also the first wine that we've made off our new property at the Cellar Door and restaurant.
That's delicious.
Yeah, I think it's drinking really well right now. I might be enjoying a few of these at the moment. 10 months in French oak, about 20% new oak on this one, and all of this Chardonnay has gone through natural
malolactic fermentation.
Malolactic fermentation. So we spoke before about the green apples. So basically it's that harsh acid converting through. So all of this wine has all gone through. So very soft and round and really nice acid line coming through.
Our bottle is sweating a little bit here because we've had it out for about half an hour, 40 minutes. Chardonnay should not be drunk directly out of your fridge. Your fridge is too cold. It's
perfect. Amen.
Yeah. It's perfect for beer. My Watts River beer is always out of the fridge. And it wants to be at your 3 to 5 degrees. Chardonnay likes to be a little bit warmer. When it's too cold, you get more of those citrus tones coming through. When it's a little bit warmer like it is now, you get that beautiful roundness, a little bit more of the tropical characters.
So if you're having a party and you've got friends over that hate Chardonnay, just put it in the fridge like you would with a Sauvignon Blanc, bring it out really cold. and you won't get those flavors.
It's wasted on them.
It is completely wasted. Totally. Yeah. This is your winter wine.
Sorry, go ahead.
I do have to say most of our beers are delicious cold, but the Brett is designed to be a bit warmer.
Good to know.
Just.
I was going to talk about that because we've focused a lot of our wines in our larder at Kangaroo Ridge Retreat on the reds because it's wintertime, right? And so what makes a really good winter white, so to say, wine?
Absolutely. Look, you know, for us, one, we just love Chardonnay, and that's why we thought we would showcase our sparkling and our Chardonnay. We'll talk about it tonight. But Chardonnay is it's just the unspoken wine. It's so elegant. It goes with lots and lots of different dishes. Mm. It's the wine that, you know, it's so diverse that you can have it unoaked and it's great by the pool and, you know, on a nice hot day. But during winter, where it is a bit chilly and you want to sit down and rug up or have a really nice, elegant dinner party, it's that wine that translates. For me, reading a book, you know, watching a good movie.
Reading a book?
Yeah, well, good movie.
And the wood is good because anyone who watches us knows that I am obsessed with oak.
Yeah. So this is we've actually taken that further this year because, like yourself, Hanna, there are lots of our wine club members who love oak. So we've actually done a single barrel Chardonnay this year.
Ooh.
All oak, all Malo. It's big.
Wow.
Yeah, and it'll only be coming out to our wine club members. So we're super excited.
Yeah.
Gotta join the club, eh?
And we'll go this Chardonnay will go absolutely perfectly with our new menu coming up too. So
yes.
One question Simon has there is what's happening post 1st of July. Sorry, 1st of June. We are opening on Friday the 5th. We're going to be open Fridays, Saturdays and Sundays.
Yep.
For lunch. We are starting for the first time ever. We're going to start doing some dinners too. So
wow.
Friday nights will be takeaway night and then Saturday night we'll be having candlelit dinners.
Yeah.
I have to try and give my children away and come.
Well, I must say, when I went there yesterday, I have to say the veranda and the outdoor area, very, very, very lovely. And you can look out onto the vineyard or the vines. It's going to be amazing in summer, even in winter, but summer as well.
Look, sorry. You know, it's been obviously a very challenging time for everyone. But, you know, during this time, we've been really proactive. So we've obviously gone through vintage and we've now come out of that. We've been really focusing on upgrading our cellar and restaurant. It's fully renovated. We have automatic roofing and blinds on our new decking.
Amazing.
Yeah, you know, we pride ourselves on being family-friendly, dog-friendly, and our biggest, you know, gripe was come, you know, July when it's raining, that people just couldn't sit outside and do that tasting with their puppies. So we've now fixed that. You know, the team has been actively working with us throughout. So we've had our head chef, you know, completely help us paint and gut the kitchen, and everyone's rearing to go to just make it a wonderful experience for everyone.
So tell us, do we have to book if we want to get in there when it come 1st of July? I mean, June.
Look, bookings are preferred, and it's pretty easy. You can just go to our website, steelsgate.com.au, and on the right-hand side down the bottom, there's a booking app. So there are different seatings to make it, you know, there's a bit of flexibility in there. But we're going to be coming out with a video this week to showcase the experience and talk about the safety protocol that we will be having in place to manage COVID-19.
Well, it's certainly unprecedented, but exciting to start slowly getting places open. So
it is really exciting. Yeah, the valley's starting to get that buzz back again, which makes it just wonderful being out here.
Sure does.
I think we've been drinking more and eating less.
It's a danger of a pandemic, I think.
No, that's homeschooling.
Yeah.
What's doing, Hanna?
We're looking at opening as well. We'll be launching an online booking system, I think, and we're looking at Friday, Saturday, Sundays opening at this stage. We're always open for takeaway, but the dine-in we will launch properly on socials before, I think it'll be Friday the 5th that we'll do the first opening, because the 1st of June is the Monday.
Yep, it is, yeah.
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 To that point.
And there's a power outage in Hillsville, surprise, oh, surprise.
Cool.
There's a power outage by us tomorrow, so, yeah, fun times. We get it a bit earlier, but, yeah.
I was going to say, to the point too, we're also going to be doing Friday night takeaway as well. So they'll be on our Facebook and Instagram pages for details. Yeah.
Do you have anybody delivering for you, or is it just pickup only?
It's pickup only at this stage. For food, yeah. We are using the Hoppet service for all our wine deliveries, and they've been amazing. So basically they're delivering Monday, Wednesday, Friday.
Oh, fantastic.
Yeah, they've been really brilliant and been able to get our wine out to all our customers very quickly.
That's great. Have you found people are actually getting interested? Because essentially with the announcement that we are able to also take bookings from the 1st of June as well, it's been a bit crazy as an accommodation provider. Kangaroo Ridge has had a lot of our weekends booked out pretty much within the space of 24 hours.
Wow.
For June and July, but we've got a couple of spots open. But have you had the same response, or is it like from your customers that you've previously had, they really want to come and see you? What's been the response?
Yeah, it's been really interesting. We're actually launching two new products to our wine club members on Friday, so all our members are really excited about doing that. But yes, the restaurant is starting to get booked, which is really exciting, especially, you know, the key days, Saturday, Sundays.
Yeah.
So that's why we do recommend booking to avoid disappointment. And it's just, I think people are ready to, you know, to get out and to do something new again. It's just making sure we all do it safely. So,
yeah. We have totally gone over time.
Yes,
even though we promised you we wouldn't.
Yeah.
This has been amazing. Thanks, guys.
Dave, thanks for having us. Getting ready. But to close off for Wednesday Winos, we always end on a high note. And what's one, and we always say one thing that has been great in the past week that has made you happy or hopeful or whatever. So what has that been for you guys?
Oh, that's an easy one for us. We had the whole team back together this week. We sat down, looked at everything we've accomplished and talked about, you know, opening our doors again. So it's a lot of excitement outside.
That's great.
Fantastic.
Yeah. Lots of energy from the team, lots of really good ideas. I think it's a lot of fun.
And
I think it's just like Brad talked about before with our renovations and stuff, and just the fact that all our team has been, you know, really behind it and, you know, putting in an effort to make it theirs. It's, you know, we are, you know, we're a family unit with this, but our whole team is part of our family. It's just really, you know, you hear that with corporate. I've been through that so many years. But when you are a small business, we've got so many people that just make us who we are. We couldn't do it without them.
Absolutely. 100%.
That's beautiful, guys.
Yeah.
I think I speak for all the parents of preps, 1s, 2s, 11s and 12s in saying that our prep went back to school and, it's been amazing. She's been loving seeing her friends again, and that's been really nice.
Awesome.
It's really good. For myself, I was very happy to get the announcement that the accommodation could open up again. It was a really big thing, and because it was unsure, there was no clarity on for a really long time. And we had guests that were, or previous guests, and also people had seen it, said, are you going to open? And we said, we don't know. We had no news. Mm. Suddenly we were able to, and then bam, everybody was, big fans of ours. So we felt very, very, very loved. And I was like, oh, gosh, that's so, so lovely to know that, we're doing a great thing for our guests. So, that was my big thing this week.
Awesome. But
thank you, Brad and Matt, for joining us.
Thanks,
guys. And thanks for the amazing wines. They're both truly outstanding. Really, really hit my spot.
Glad you enjoyed, guys. Thanks for having us. Really appreciate it.
Yeah, it's been great.
So, just hang on for a second. I'm just going to drop you offline, but don't hang up on there because we're going to announce who we've got for next week. Because Hanna, why don't you tell us what's happening next week? Because I'm really, really, really excited about this.
We've got Emily from Froth Magazine joining us, and we've yet to decide exactly what we're tasting, but it'll be something beery, and we'll make that announcement hopefully by Friday.
All right, fantastic. So I'm excited because, yeah. Emily from Frost. All right. Well, thank you, everyone, for joining us on Wednesday Winos. See you next week and have a lovely week in between. Bye.